Right, since the time is 12:40, we'll start this lecture. I hope you can see my screen and hear my voice clearly. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So today we are moving to a new topic. So up to this point, we have discussed about the sorting algorithm. So from today onwards, I mean, actually maybe only today, we'll start a new data structure known as hash table. So you might have learned about different data structures by this moment, about binary trees, linked lists, arrays, and etc. So this hash table is another data structure which is used in different use cases, such as caching and in password management. The significance of this hash table is that its intention is to reduce the insertion, deletion, and searching time complexity, which is found in other data structures. So we will first discuss a bit about the complexity of those data structures and then move into the hash table. Right. So first we'll discuss about linear search, which elements or which data structures will involve a linear search. What is linear search? Right. So you can see here an array of elements is stored in an array known as capital A. So in linear search, we make a simple assumption that when we are searching for a particular element in the array, we don't know the index or the address of that particular element that we are going to search. For example, if in this array, if we are going to search for one, number one, we don't know the location of that element. That means we don't know, so this is A0, A1, and A2. We don't know it is in A2. So we have to search one by one. So how to search? First, it goes to the first element and see whether the value is one. No. Go to the second element and see whether the value is one. When it goes to the third element only, it will see that the value is one. So it has been found. So what about the complexity? So it ran, so it searched three elements. So the number of elements search is proportional to the location of that element. So if the element is in the first position, then the complexity is theta one. If it is the last element, it is theta n. N is the size of this array. So that means if you are searching for the last element, it has the worst case complexity. That means theta n. And if you are searching for the first element, then we have the least complexity or the best case scenario of theta one. The complexity is only one operation. Right, so that means, so the search is proportional to the location of that element. So we have to search one by one, one element by one, one by one. So as you have known about the linked list also, in linked lists also you have to, if you want to search an element or insert a new element, you have to go from one element to the other and do that. So it also operation is similar to this array operation searching. So from this one, the worst case and the best case, the average case complexity can be calculated. That is average of worst case and best case. So you can get the average of this one and this one by adding this one and divide by 2. So the average worst case, average case complexity is this one plus this one divided by 2. That is theta n plus theta 1 divided by 2. So when you add this one, it is again theta n. So in when the array size is high, in asymptotic analysis, when the array size is high, the average case complexity also reduces to the length of the array. So when average case complexity is also in the order of n. So this type of search is known as linked list. So linear list, linear search. So this search is true for linked list also. As I told you, you have to go one element by one to search the element. But so we have made an assumption in searching in the beginning. That means we don't know the index of the array or the location of the element. But if the location of the element is known, then the searching complexity is always theta 1. Why? So when you know that this number 3, for example, is in A3, capital A, third index, then you can directly access this element, direct access. So this is known as direct access. So if we know the address of an element, even in linked list or in array, if the address of that element is directly known, then we need not to search for that one. If the address is not known, then we have to search. So in that case, when we are no need to search, that means the address is known, the searching complexity is always one operation. Only one operation is involved. So the motivation or the intention for going for hash table is to get this kind of direct access. Direct access, that means using some value of the input, we are going to calculate the address of that element. So this is number 3. So based on number 3, we are going to do a calculation and find the address of that one to find that location. So that is what is done in a hash table. So but in arrays, there is no mechanism to find any number stored using this number. So using number 1, there is no algorithm to search that this is in third location, or in other terms A2. There is no mechanism to determine this number 1 is in A2 unless this is sorted. So we are not talking about a sorted array, we are talking about just a random array which numbers have been stored. So there is no way to get this thing known as direct access. That means knowing the address of that element by using the stored number. There are no mechanisms in arrays and linked lists. So what is the background is, so this type of searching one element by one is known as linear search. So this is known as linear search. And in linear search, we don't know the address or the index of searching element. Okay, so that is all about linear search. So we'll move on to what is known as binary search. Okay, so binary search is done in binary tree data structure, as the name suggests. So get an example where there is a binary tree and the order of storing in that binary tree is according to this algorithm. So what is that algorithm? The left child stores the lower value than the value stored in the parent, and the right child stores a higher value than the value stored in the parent. So the binary tree can be created according to any algorithm with the user wants. If you want to get, so last week we discussed about heap data structure. So in heap data structure, what is the main point of the algorithm? It is the parent node is always higher than the child nodes. That is in heap data structure, specifically max heap. In min heap, the parent node is always lesser than each of its child nodes. But in a general binary tree data structure, what is going to happen is it will store the left child as the child which is having a value less than the parent node, and the right child as the value having higher than the parent node. That is the general case. So in that case, you can imagine that in the tree, the root node will have the middle value of the number sequence. So if we are going to store a set of integers, for say about 1000 integer values, you are going to store in the binary tree. So according to the algorithm, that the left child is having low values and right child is having higher values than the parent node, then in the binary tree, the rightmost leaf node will contain the maximum value, and the leftmost leaf node will contain the minimum value. Leftmost leaf node will contain the minimum value. Rightmost leaf node will contain the maximum value, and the root node will have around the middle value. It is not always true, but in average, if the tree is some kind of balanced tree, in that case, the root node will have the middle value, right? So in such a case, what will happen is, if you are going to find the middle value, that will be the best case. That means once you enter the tree, so you enter the tree from the root node. So you first search the root node. So when you, at the moment you enter the root node, then you will find that value. So there is only one operation. So that is, the complexity is theta 1, right? So if you want to find the least value or the highest value, then you have to traverse the whole tree downwards. So in one level, as you have learned about the binary trees, you will know that there are levels in the binary tree. The number of levels in the binary tree is log 2n plus 1. So in the worst case, that is either finding the minimum value or maximum value, you have to traverse to the bottom of the tree. So you have to traverse log 2n plus 1 times. So the complexity is log 2n plus 1. And in the asymptotic analysis, when n is high, this plus 1 can be neglected. So in asymptotic analysis, this will become log 2n when n is high. Right. So from this one, again, we can calculate the average search complexity for a general binary tree, not the heap data structure or any other specific binary tree data structure, but the general binary tree search complexity by, just like before, we get the average of worst case and best case. So that is this one and this one, divide by 2. So again, compared to 1, log 2n value is a higher value. So divide by 2 is a scale value. So we can neglect those two. And again, the complexity is, so the worst case and average case complexity is same when n is large. So remember that this is the asymptotic analysis, not for smaller values of n, like n equal 4, 8, not that value. That is at least when n is greater than 1000. When n is about greater than 1000, this is true. Asymptotic analysis, remember that always n is large, as we discussed in the first few lectures. Right, so this is, so you can see that the binary search is more efficient than linear search. So rather than storing in array, if you store in a binary tree, the searching is fast, because log 2 n is greater than theta n. So sorry, lesser than theta n. Theta n is greater than log 2 n. Log 2 n is a lesser value than n. Log 2 n is lesser than n. So the searching complexity is lesser in binary trees than in arrays and linked list, where the linear search is involved. But the fact is, the insertion and deletion complexity is higher than arrays, because you need to rearrange, you need to first search, then rearrange the tree, to satisfy this condition, left child and right child, as this one, you need to rearrange the tree. So in that case, the insertion and deletion complexity will be greater than those of arrays. So in arrays, if you want to delete a particular node or insert a particular node, you just have, for example, when inserting, you just have to add an element at the empty location or at the end of the array. But you cannot do that for binary trees. So if the inserting element is higher than the least value, then that means you have to insert somewhere in the middle of the binary tree. So then you have to do some SAP operations and remove some nodes and rearrange some nodes. So that will consume time. So the complexity is higher in insertion and deletion in binary trees than arrays. So those kind of pros and cons are there. So the today's discussion is not on both binary search or linear search. So I'm discussing this as a background for hash table data structure, right? Okay, so this is binary search. So now we will move on to the hash tables. So before seeing what is a hash table, we need to look at what kind of data or in what format the data is going to be stored in hash tables, right? So I still have not introduced what is a hash table. So we'll see what data item, then you can know the concept of the hash table, right? So we'll move on to what is this data item. So the main concept of storing data in hash tables is done in something known as key value pairs. And the key is the one which is going to uniquely identify the location in hash table. So we'll see what these key value pairs are, right? So the key is going to uniquely identify the content in value. The key is used to uniquely identify the content in value, and value is the content, at the actual content of that thing identified by the key. So using an example, you will understand. Okay, I have got this example. So you know that one person can only have, I mean, one person can have many mobile phone numbers, but for a given mobile phone number, there is only one person. For a given mobile phone number, there is only one person. So using the mobile phone number, you can uniquely identify a person. Using a mobile phone number, you can uniquely identify a person. That means you can use mobile phone number as a key. And so using that key, so the key is used to identify that person. So once you identify in the value part, so there is key value pairs. So in the once you identify a particular thing, for example, in this example, a person using a mobile phone number, using that identification, you can store as many data as you want in the value part. So in the value part, you can store the person name, age, address, anything related to that particular person. So the number of values is undefined. I mean, you can store any amount of values as you want in the value section. And the important thing is the key. So the key should have a property that it is unique to that particular entity. So in this example, mobile phone number is unique to a person. So that mobile phone number is not allocated to another person. There is only one person registered under a given mobile phone number. So likewise, that is the concept of key, right? So I have written down some examples. Using this example, you can identify what is known as this key value pair. So this is an example from mobile phone number. This is the value. So the value I have enclosed within these curly brackets. So this whole thing is the value, and inside that value, what is known as value, you can store any amount of attributes or properties. So these are just examples for key value pairs. So these are the things which you store in hash tables. So this is the data item for hash table. So how to implement this? So you know, this is the data item that is stored in hash table data structure. So now we will write a small code to declare this. So you might have known about the structures in programming languages. So this data item can also be considered as a structure. So each instance can be an instance of a structure, and these key values are nothing but the properties or the attributes of that structure. So for this example, you can declare a structure known as person, and these key values are nothing but the attributes. But the fact is, the most important thing is this key attribute must be unique. So it cannot have a duplicate value within different instances of the structure. That should be unique to a given instance of a structure, right? So we'll declare this data structure, right? So this data item is a data structure, right? So you can use the keyword struct and declare. So this is the generic implementation. So in your programs, you can use any name you want. So I have used the data item name. So this is just a generic specification. So here, this key need not to be a set of numbers. This key can be a string. String means a set of letters, or I mean alphanumeric characters, a combination of letters and digits. This key need not to be a always digits. It can be letters also, or any other special character. So the generic implementation of this key is a string. So we declare the structure and give it a name, and there are no arguments. So this is not a method. This is a structure. There are no arguments in structures. So it is having a key. So the generic implementation is a string. So this can have a string, alphanumeric characters. And so in structures, what we are going to do is we are just declaring the properties. So this is the property. This is the first property, and it should be unique. Unique. So you can even, so to be correct, you can declare it with the unique statement. So this is just a pseudo code. So this what is the keyword used as the unique will differ from different programming language to programming language. So it may be static in some programming languages, or any other keyword using in C++ or C#, or any other programming language implementation, that will be different. So this one should be something like primary or the unique. So this value cannot be same in different structures. And as the second, so as the value, you can declare a set of other attributes, value 1, value 2, of different data types. They need not to be the same data type also. You can use double, strings, or integers, any data type you can use. So this set is value. This is the key. So the importance of key and others as value, you will understand in a little moment when you get to know what is hash tables, right? Okay. So to know about the importance, so this is the key importance of the hash table data structure. In hash table data structure, we use something known as the hash function, or some people even refer to this as hash algorithm also. So we'll use the term hash function. So in hash function, what is done is using the key. So there is key value pairs. Using the key, it will do some numerical calculation and give out a result. Using the key, it will do some numerical calculation and give out a result, and that result will be used to find the location or the address of the hash table. So there is a data structure known as hash table, right? And you have the key value pairs to store. So using the key, it will do some calculation, numerical calculation, and find the location of the of where this key value pair is stored in the hash table. So using the key, it will do a calculation. But in contrast, in arrays, in array data structure, using the value that is stored, it did not determine the location where it should be stored. It was just stored either at the end or any place that the user desired. The location of storing was not determined by the data itself. But in binary trees, there was some based on the value. whether it is higher or less than the root node, its position was determined. That's why its searching complexity was lesser than arrays, because based on the value, its address was determined. But even that one, the complexity was not theta 1. That means in searching complexity was not theta 1, it was log 2n. Even when determining the address of insertion based on the data or the value, even the binary tree could not reduce the complexity of searching. But in hash tables, so this hash function, using this hash function, it will calculate a value. That value is known as index. So we'll move on. So as I told you, in hash table, based on a key, a hash function is used to obtain something known as index. Something known as index. So in hash tables also, we have an array known as hash array. This hash array is nothing, not the same array as a normal array, but this hash array is used to store, is hash array is used to store this index or the location of the elements of the hash table. This hash array is used to store the address or the location of elements of the hash table. So you can imagine a hash table as an array where this index is stored or the location is stored. But the fact is, this index or the location is determined based on the hash function. You calculated using the key. And in that hash array, at that specific location pointed out by this index, this calculated index. So this calculated index is used to find the location of the hash array. And at that point, not only the value is stored, but it will be stored as key value pair. So this key value pair is stored at the location pointed out by this index. So this hash function is nothing in simply a calculation applied to the key. So for example, so there is a key and you have a hash function. So hash function, you can get the key as the input, and it will return or output known as index. So using this index, you can find the location of the hash array. You can find the location of the hash array. Right, so this is the equation. So you can get the index by running hash function on the key, and at the location of this index pointed out by hash array, you can store the key value pair. You can store the key value pair in that location. So this is the concept behind the hash function of the hash table. So now we move on to an example of a hash function. So now you know the concept of hash function. So an example for a hash function could be, so in the previous example, of which I use some telephone numbers as the index. So in that case, hash function could be user defined. It could be anything as the user defines. It is not limited to this one. It can be a design of the user. So this is one of the design. So there are strings or input characters. So you may know that from this moment, so for each character of the keyboard that you enter, there is a corresponding ASCII code. ASCII code is an 8-bit code. So there is an 8-bit code assigned for each character of the keyboard. So based on that keyboard, that ASCII character of the each of the keys of the keyboard, there is a value. For example, I'm just taking an example. So for the letter A, you may have the ASCII code as 58. ASCII code may be 58. And for letter B, it may be 59. So for the letter or the digit one, it may have another ASCII code. So likewise, you have a number for an ASCII code. So in this hash function, it will add up the ASCII code of each of the characters and get the mod. So what is this mod operation? That is remainder of division. Modulus or mod operation is you get this sum and divide by this number and get the remainder. So this is a simple example for a hash function. So what is this? The value this is which is divided or this number is typically in most of the hash algorithms or the hash functions, what is being divided is the address array size, or in other words, this hash array size. So in hash table, this hash array size is limited, maybe 10 entries, or maybe 100 entries, or maybe 1000 entries. So the number of addresses which are stored inside this hash table may be limited. For example, there may be 10,000 of telephone numbers. For the example that I took, there may be 10,000 telephone numbers, but there may be only 100 hash array entries. There may be 100 hash array entries. So in that case, this will be 100. The size of the hash array will be 100. So you cannot have all the inputs mapped to one element of the hash array all the time. The hash array size may be smaller in most cases. So this is one of the example for this one. So now we'll see how this hash function is implemented, or rather the pseudo code for this hash function. So the pseudo code will be different if this hash function was another one. So you can define the hash function according to the requirement of the user. The hash function will be different. So for this one, we'll write a hash function. So what will be the output of the hash function? You must get the index as the output of the hash function. So index will be the output. So the return type of the hash function should be of integer data type. The return type should be integer. And this is the name hash function. And it has two inputs. What are the two inputs? So the hash function is calculated based on this key. Hash function is calculated based on this key, and you must know the size of this hash array. You must know the size. So for this example, there may be example this hash array size is fixed. So in that case, you need not to specify this second argument, but typically the size of the hash array also passed as an input to the hash function. So you have the key, which is the one which is going to determine this index, and the size of the hash array. Okay, so what we are going to get is the sum of this ASCII code of each of these characters. So we need to set a variable known as sum, and we initialize that to zero when we begin this function. And we need to return what is known as index. So we declare a variable known as index and initialize it to zero, right? Then we run a loop to get the sum, this ASCII code sum of each character. So until the length, so we consider this key, we consider this key as an array of characters. So an string is an array of characters, array of single characters. So we need to get the ASCII code of each of these single characters and add it to the sum. So how to do that is by using this sum equals sum plus key, ith element of the key. So key is the string. So from this array of characters, we consider the ith character. So when I equals zero, it will be the first character. And using the single quotes, we get the ASCII code. So if this was key I, it is the value of that character. And using the single quotes, we get the ASCII code. So we get the ASCII code of the ith character and add it to sum. So when this loop is run until i equal length minus 1, that is the last element, then you get the sum of the ASCII characters. You get the sum of the ASCII characters. And you need to then do this operation. So the index will be sum mod size. So the index is equal to sum mod size. And at last you need to return this value as index. You need to return this value as index. So this is how you write